Dear learners, the talk is on adjustments in final accounts. So, dear learners, I just want to tell you that basically when we talk about final accounts, it is only the trading profit and loss and balance sheet which constitute the final accounts. So before we go ahead, I would like to tell you the main objectives of preparing the final accounts, why in fact the final accounts are prepared, who prepare the final accounts, their objectives, and the adjustments which need to be incorporated while preparing the final accounts, what is the necessity of adjustments being incorporated in financial statements. So dear learners, you all might be well aware about the business, that in every business there are n number of transactions which need to be recorded during the financial year. So in fact, dear learners, these business transactions do not carry any meaning until or unless such business transactions are recorded in the books of the accounts very systematically and very scientifically. Because simply by recording the business transactions in a chronological order will not at all serve the purpose of the businessman, and it won't serve the purpose of the different stakeholders, and the different stakeholders may be the shareholder, may be the employees, may be the debtor of that organizations, may be the creditors of that organizations, may be the society at large. So there are various stakeholders who have vested their interest in a particular organization. So therefore, these business transactions are recorded in a very systematic and in a very scientific manner. So when we use the term systematic and scientific manner, it means these transactions must reflect a true and fair picture of the business organization. Because dear learners, sometimes what happens that when we record the business transactions in the books of the accounts, sometimes it really becomes very difficult to identify a particular group of transactions. And at a particular point of time, if we do not identify the transactions which we generally and which we very quickly require, then the very purpose is defeated. Therefore, it is the focus is given on recording the business transactions very systematically and very scientifically, so that at any point of time, as and when the different stakeholders want to know the exact positions of any particular transactions, they can trace it very easily without any sort of problem. That is why the transactions need to be recorded in the books of the accounts at an appropriate place. So recording the business transactions at an appropriate place is what we call systematic and scientific way of recording the business transactions. The second important thing is that when we record the business transaction, yes, of course, because the memory of the human being is not that much, you know, vast and fast, that the all business transactions which need to be recorded in the books of the accounts during a particular financial year, that the businessman can recollect all the business transactions. No, this is the limitation of the human being, that he cannot recollect all the information. He cannot recollect all the business transactions as and when they require. Therefore, they need to be recorded so that no transactions can be left out. And the another important thing is that only the purpose of recording the business transaction is not to record the business transactions. Very simple. See, sometimes what happen when the number of transactions are numerous, when the number of transactions are in lakhs, then really it is very, very difficult to manage those transactions, because you know that we have a different kinds of transaction. The transactions may be related to the purchase, the transactions may be related to the sales, the transactions may be related to the cash transaction, transactions may be related to the credit transaction. So the necessity of recording the business transactions in a very systematic and scientific manner is that they need to be recorded at an appropriate place. Say, for example, all the business transactions which are related to the cash must be recorded in the cash book, because it is the only cash book which make we people acquaint about the cash position of a particular business for a particular period of time. So when we want to know the cash position of a particular business, then definitely, in spite of going through each and every book, we simply focus on the cash book, and just by going through the cash book, we can easily come to know about the inflows of cash during the year and outflow of cash during the year, and the total balance available with the organization as far as the cash position is concerned. So therefore, if we want to know about the sales, see, dear learners, one thing is very important in order to understand these concepts properly, that see, sometimes what happens, we say purchase book, sometimes we say purchase account, sales book, sales account. So we must be in a position to identify the difference between these two. Say, if I talk about purchase book and purchase account, so if I refer to the purchase book, in purchase book only the credit purchase will be recorded. So if a particular person wants to know the exact position of transaction, exact position of purchase transactions which are related to the credit purchase, he simply need to go through the purchase book. And when you want to know the overall position of the purchase, whether the purchase is a cash purchase or it is a credit purchase, then definitely, instead of going through the purchase book, one is supposed to go through the purchase account. So purchase account is basically a wider concept in which cash purchase and credit purchase, both the transactions are recorded, whereas in a purchase book only purchase transactions which are related to the credit purchase will find a place. So therefore, we must first be very clear whether we want to know the exact position of the credit purchase or total purchase. So if you want to know the exact position of the total purchase, then we must go through the purchase account, and if we want to know the credit purchase only, then definitely we should go through the purchase book only, right? So dear learners, this is what we call that classification of account, that the transactions which are of similar nature, they need to be recorded at one place, because there are numerous transactions in the business, and it is very, very difficult to identify the particular transactions when they are not classified properly, when they are not recorded at an appropriate place. Therefore, the transactions must be classified and must be recorded at the appropriate place so that they can easily be identified and traced whenever required. Then, dear learners, recording the business transaction has already taken place. Then the second step is classification has already taken place. So no doubt recording the business transaction and classifying the business transaction is basically a process of preparing the financial statements, preparing the financial accounts. Therefore, the third step is summarizing, because classification of business transaction is a second step, which is basically a step ahead to the first stage, that is recording of business transaction. Now, summarizing, what we mean by summarizing is that until or unless these transactions are analyzed properly, perhaps the very purpose of the business will be defeated. Because sometimes what happens, students, if I say that during a particular year I have made a sale of rupees 50,000 or 50 lakh, so perhaps it will not serve my purpose, because enhancing the sale is very good for the business, but it is not the ultimate aim, because the ultimate aim of the business is to enhance the profit, to earn the profit. So just if I say that this year the sale has increased by 200% or by 300%, will not serve any purpose and probably will not give any meaningful informations to the investors. Or if I say that the fixed assets of the business have gone up 70% in comparison to the last year, so again it will not serve my purpose. Or if I say that the operational expenses have come down by 25% as compared to the last year, again it will not serve my purpose. So dear learners, the stakeholders, the different parties who have vested their interest, they are not interested in getting these sort of informations. They are interested to know the financial position, the profitability position, on the basis of which they want to take their investment decision. Because it is only the financial soundness, it is only the profitability of the business which encourage the stakeholders to invest their funds in a particular business. And wherever they find that the financial soundness of a particular business is very good, then they can take a decision to invest their funds in that particular business organization. Because if they feel that the financial position of a particular business is not sound enough, then really they will be under the apprehension whether the amount which is going to be invested by them will come back or not, whether that particular business organization will be in a position to make a regular payment of interest or not. Because if I want to take the decision to invest my funds in a particular business organization, then definitely my first and prime concerns would be to get back my principal amount and a regular payment of my interest. So if these two things are satisfied, then of course I can think of about investing my funds in that particular business organization. Therefore, this step is going to get a very much importance, because this is the only step where we can take a right decision. See, when we want to know the financial position of a particular business and profitability position of a particular business, then we need to go through the financial statements, that is final accounts. So under the head final accounts, there are three statements which need to be prepared. The first one is trading account, then profit and loss account, and then balance sheet. So dear learners, the question arises that the organizations which are involved in manufacturing, then definitely they need to prepare first the manufacturing account. Instead of preparing the trading account, they will prepare a manufacturing account, then profit and loss account, and then balance sheet. And the organizations which are simultaneously manufacturing and involved in the trading activities, then first of all they need to prepare a manufacturing account, then trading account, then profit and loss account, and then balance sheet. So this is how these statements are prepared. So once these statements are prepared, we say that the final accounts of a particular business organizations are prepared. Now we will try to focus how these financial statements are prepared. So first one is trading account. See, dear learner, in trading account it is very simple that basically we have two sides of the account, debit side and credit sides. So in the debit side of trading account, we start with the opening stock. So whatever amount of opening stock, which opening stock of finished goods, so here opening stock means opening stock of finished goods. So whatever amount of opening stock which is with us, we must record it in the debit side of trading account. And then the amount of purchases that we have made during the current financial year. So then purchases, then all the direct expenses. The direct expenses may be related to the trading activities of the business, and in case if the firm is involved in the manufacturing process, then any expenses which is related to the manufacturing process of the organization should also come under the head of direct expenses. So here the student must easily understand the difference between the direct and indirect expenses. So any expenses which is of a direct nature of the production process, say for example, sometimes when the amount of expenses increase with the volume of the production, and when the amount of expenses decrease with the decreased volume of the production. So if there is a direct relationship with the volume of the production, such expenses are known as direct expenses. Say for example, if we want to produce more, then definitely for producing more we need to buy more raw material, we need to employ more labor. So for that we need to pay more in order to procure more raw material, in order to employ more labor we need to pay more wages to them. So any expenses which increases or decreases with the volume of the production is known as direct expenses. Then we need to record the business transaction in the credit side of the trading account. Say for example, the sales that we have made during the year will be recorded in the credit side of trading account. Then in case if any sales return is there, then the amount of sales return must be deducted from the amount of sales. Then closing stock. So whatever amount of closing stock of finished goods is with us, that amount of closing stock should also be recorded in the credit side of trading account. Now these are the two sides, debit side and the credit side of the trading account. Now we should compare both the side, debit side and credit side. So in case if the debit side of the trading account is more than the debit side, more than the credit side of trading account, then definitely we will generate gross loss. And if the credit side of the trading account is in excess of the debit side of the trading account, then definitely it would generate gross profit. So at the end of the year, when we will close the trading account, we will have either gross profit or gross loss. So if the credit side is in excess, then the debit side gross profit will be there, or vice versa. Then the second account or the second statement is profit and loss account. So dear learner, when we prepare the profit and loss account, we must keep one thing in mind, that all the indirect expenses must be recorded in the debit side and all incomes of the business must be recorded in the credit side. So the net result of trading account, that is either gross profit or gross loss. So if the gross profit is there, so gross profit is always written in the debit side of the trading account. Therefore, while transferring the balance of gross profit to the profit and loss account, it would come under the credit side of profit and loss account. And if gross loss is there, gross loss is always recorded in the credit side of trading account, and while transferring the balance of the gross loss to the profit and loss account, it would be transferred to the debit side of profit and loss account. And then we need to record all the expenses, indirect expenses and losses of the business in the debit side of profit and loss account, and all the revenues of the business must be recorded in the credit side of profit and loss account. The expenses and losses which need to be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account may be the depreciation, because no business, no organization can survive until or unless the appropriate amount of fixed assets are with the business. Because we need fixed assets. Fixed assets may be our land, building, plant, machine, furniture. So these are quite essentials in order to run a business smoothly. So dear learners, you know that when we employ all these things in the business, these things get depreciated over a period of time. So whatever amount of depreciation take place on account of wear and tear, on account of usage of the assets, that amount of depreciation is recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account. The bad debts. See, sometimes dear learners, what happens that in order to enhance the sales of the business, in order to enhance the profitability of the business, we extend credit facilities to our customer. So sometimes the credit facilities which we have extended to our customer, so that credit facility, you know, may sometimes prove to be very dangerous for the business. Say for example, if you have sold the goods to your customer worth rupees 2 crore on credit basis. So sometimes you know that when the amount from your customers do not come back at the right time, then it can create problem for the business. And sometimes the amount which we have given to the customer, the goods which we have sold to the customer on credit basis, sometimes it is witnessed that 100% of the amount which we have taken on account of selling the goods on the credit basis may not realize by the business. So the amount which could not be realized, that amount is known as bad debts, कि वो पैसा हमारा recover नहीं हुआ. But at the same time, we have to take these risks, because this is the era of cutthroat competition. In a competitive world, we can not survive until or unless we follow the market policies, until or unless we follow the market trends. Because if we do not extend the credit facilities, then someone else will extend the credit facilities to the buyers, and our customers will automatically divert to those business organization, and ultimately we will have to close down our business. Therefore, extending the credit facility to the customer has again become very, very important, and we cannot avoid, we cannot ignore these things these days. Then the expenses which we have incurred on advertisement. So again, this is the expenditure for the business which need to be recorded in the debit side. Then amount spent on telegram, postage, advertisement, rent, taxes. So these are the few examples of expenses which need to be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account. Then in the credit side of profit and loss account, all incomes, revenues which the business has generated must be recorded in the credit side. See, sometimes in case the business has received some sort of interest or commission or any brokerage, etc., on account of making trading activities, then such incomes and revenues, such gains must be recorded on the credit side of the profit and loss account. And then at the end of the year, when we close the profit and loss account, then either we would generate net profit or net loss. So if the credit side is in excess than the debit side of the profit and loss account, then of course we will generate net profit. And if the debit side is in excess than the credit side, it would generate net loss. So this is how, dear learners, these statements are prepared. Then the next one is balance sheet. So dear learners, what happens that when we prepare the balance sheet need to be prepared very systematically, and it must give a true meaning to the different stakeholders who have vested their interests. So again, when we talk about balance sheet has again two sides, liability side and asset side. The right hand side is known as asset side and the left hand side is known as liability side. So in the liability side, whatever liabilities which the business own, that liabilities need to be recorded in the debit side of balance sheet. Say for example, the proprietor's capital. So when the business need to be closed down, the amount of capital invested by the proprietor need to be refunded by the business. Then the amount of creditors, the suppliers who have supplied the goods to you on credit basis, they are your creditor, therefore it need to be recorded in the liability side. Or in case if you have taken the loan from the banks or from the financial institution, that again liabilities in terms of loan, that also need to be recorded in the debit side of balance sheet. Then outstanding expenses. Sometimes what happens, dear learners, that the outstanding expenses are those expenses that we have already taken the advantage of services, but we have not paid for those services. Say for examples, if we have taken the services of a labor for a particular period, but we have not made the payment for that particular period to the labor. So therefore, until or unless we make the payment to the labor, that amount will stand as liabilities. It means that amount has to be paid by the business to the laborer who had already extended his services to the business. So this is what we call outstanding liabilities, which need to be recorded in the liability side. Then in the asset side, again we have fixed assets, we have current assets. So dear learners, we must record the assets and liabilities in a balance sheet in a very systematic and in a very chronological order. See, when we record the assets in the asset side of the balance sheet, we must be very particular that first of all we should record the fixed assets, which may be land and building, plant and machine, furniture, vehicle, etc. And because these are the fixed assets, it means the assets which are invested in the business for earning. And the second one is current assets. So these are the current assets which are more into liquid forms, which we can convert into cash within a very short span of time. That is why such assets are known as current assets. Say for example, the debtor. The debtors are the customers to whom you have extended the credit facilities. Now you have to recover the amount from them, and this credit facility generally less than for a period of less than 1 year. Then the amount of stock, then the amounts of bills receivable, the amount which is with the business, the amount deposited at bank, or the prepaid expenses, it means the expenses which you have already paid in advance. So these are the few examples of current assets. So these must be recorded systematically. Likewise, in the liability side, first we need to record the outside liabilities, and then fixed liabilities, short-term liabilities. So accordingly, we should make a pattern, and accordingly we should follow that pattern very strictly so that no ambiguity is left out. Dear learners, yes, now the most important thing is that while preparing the final accounts of a particular business organization, the question arises about adjustments in final accounts. So what are these adjustments, and why the adjustments need to be incorporated while preparing the final accounts? So dear learners, you know that when we prepare the financial statements, sometimes what happens that inadvertently there are some transactions which are left out, or there are transactions which are recorded properly at right place, but the amount of such transactions is not recorded properly, or the amount which have been recorded but not fully recorded, or the transactions which have been recorded in the business but not properly recorded, or the transactions which have not been recorded in the business. So when you know we prepare the final accounts, and after closing the financial statements, when these things are revealed by the business, then we have only one option, that we need to provide these sort of informations as adjustments, as additional informations. And while preparing the financial statements, we need to keep a record of all these informations, and we need to incorporate these additional informations while preparing the financial statement. So any informations which is revealed after closing the final accounts, such informations need to be furnished as an adjustments or as an additional information under the trial balance. And these informations need to be considered while preparing the final accounts of the business. Now we will see how these adjustments are to be considered while preparing the financial statements. So let us have a look one by one how these adjustments need to be recorded. So first adjustment is, dear learner, about closing stock. So dear learners, you all might be knowing about the closing stock, that this is the amount of stock which is left unsold at the end of the year. So when the amount of closing stock is given in the adjustments, then dear learners, you must be very very careful while treating the amount of closing stocks while preparing the financial statements, that any informations which is given as additional informations or which is given in adjustments need to be recorded at two different places simultaneously, at minimum at two different places simultaneously. And any informations which is given in the trial balance, so that information must be recorded only at one place, appropriate place. So now the question arises, when the information is given that the amount of closing stock, say for example, is 50,000, it is given in adjustment. So if it is given in adjustment, then the amount of closing stock would be recorded first in the credit side of the trading account, and then while preparing the balance sheet, the amount of closing stock, that is rupees 50,000, will also be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet, because any unsold item is treated as an asset for the business. Therefore, it is recorded in the asset side of the business. So here, when the amount of closing stock is given in the adjustment, the journal entry would be, as you see, that stock account debit to trading account. So here, stock is debited because stock is asset. And dear learners, in the last lecture, as I had already told you, that all the assets come under real account, and the rule of the real account is debit what comes in and credit what goes out. And all the assets have a debit balance. Therefore, the stock would be debited and the trading account would be credited. Then the second one is outstanding expenses. So, dear learners, outstanding expenses, again, this is the second adjustment. Outstanding expenses, these are the expenses against which we have already taken the benefits, but we have not made the payment so far. Just now, I had given you an example that we had already taken the benefits of services extended by the laborers, but we have not made the payment of their salaries. So, until or unless we make the payment of the wages to the laborer, till that point, the outstanding expenses will be shown. The expenses, and by the time we make the full payment of all these expenses, outstanding expenses will automatically become nil. So, outstanding expenses mean that you have to make the payment to the persons, and you have already taken the benefits of the services from that person, but the payment has not been made so far. So, unless you clear the payment, outstanding expenses will stand still, right? So, now the question arises, dear learners, when the amount of outstanding expenses is given in the trial balance, then what would be the treatment? So, this expenses is an expenses for the business, whether we have made the payment or not made the payment. So, expenses is an expenses. So, it would be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account. And when the amount of outstanding expenses is given in the adjustments, in the additional informations, in such cases, first, the outstanding expenses will be added to the concerned expenses and would be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account. And second time, amount of outstanding expenses will also be shown in the liability side of the balance sheet, because against the benefit which we have already taken on account of services performed by a particular person, we have not made the payment of that facilities. So, unless we make the payment of such services, such liabilities will stand still. Therefore, we will have to clear the payment, only then we can remove it from the liability side. So, unless we make the payment, we will have to show it as liabilities in the liability side of the balance sheet. Then the third one is prepaid expenses or unexpired expenses or expenses paid in advance. So, prepaid expenses, you know, dear learners, it is just, you know, opposite to the outstanding expenses. So, prepaid expenses, the expenses which we have paid in advance. So, I can make you understand with the help of the example. See, for example, our financial year is from 1st January to 31st of December 2012, right? So what happened that we make the payment of the insurance to the insurance company on account of getting the assets of our business insured. Say for example, we are paying rupees 1,000 per month. So the total amount is rupees 12,000. And we presume that we have insured the assets of our business in the month of June, 1st June. So January, February, March, April, May. 5 months have already gone. We have insured the assets of the business from 1st of June 2012. And what we did is that we paid rupees 12,000 on 1st June 2012 for the full year. That is from 1st June 2012 to 30th May 2013. For complete 1 year, we have made a payment of rupees 12,000. But dear learner, we are quite aware that we are preparing the financial statements from 1st January 2012 to 31st December 2012. So for this particular current year, only 7 months comes under this current year, that is from 1st June 2012 to 31st December 2012. So only the expenses which are related to the current year. So current year's period stands for 7 months only, that is from 1st June 2012 to 31st December 2012. So therefore, rupees 7,000 would be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account, and rupees 5,000 is the prepaid expenses, that is expenses paid in advance. It means 5 months insurance premium which we have already paid in advance for the next year. Because for this year it is only 7,000. For rupees 1,000 per month, if we are making the insurance of our fixed assets on 1st June, so 1st June to 31st December only 7 months, 7,000 rupees. But we have paid 12,000. So therefore, rupees 5,000 we have made the payment in advance. So this is what we call prepaid expenses, unexpired expenses, or expenses paid in advance. So let us see how the expenses, prepaid expenses or expenses paid in advance will be treated in the books of the account. So if the amount of prepaid expenses is given in the trial balance, then amount of prepaid expenses would only be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet. It will not at all be recorded in the credit side of profit and loss account. It will only be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet. But if the amount of prepaid expenses is given in adjustment, then I have already told you that any information given in the adjustment will definitely be recorded minimum at two places simultaneously. So the treatment would be that the amount of prepaid expenses, that is 5 months, so out of 12,000, 5 month expenses will be deducted. That is only 7 months, 7,000 rupees will be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account. It means any amount which is prepaid expenses. So here in this information, prepaid expenses are 5,000, that is for 5 months. So these 5 months will be deducted from the total expenses, that is 12,000. So only 7,000 would be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account. And 5,000 rupees, that is unexpired expenses or expenses paid in advance, would be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet. Then third one is accrued income or income receivable. So dear learners, it means we have already extended the services to the organization, and against those services we have not been paid so far. So again, this is our asset. So now the question arises that how such informations would be incorporated while preparing the final accounts of the business. Income receivable or accrued income, or income unearned income, or income received in advance. So very simple, income receivable should be recorded in the credit side of profit and loss account, because income receivable, we have already earned the income but we have not received it. So sometimes what happens that any income which we have already earned for a particular period must be recorded then and there only, whether it is received or not. Because dear learners, you must keep one thing in mind that the sometimes final accounts may be prepared on cash basis system, but generally in India the financial statements, the final accounts are prepared on accrual basis of accounting, not on cash basis of accounting. So it is only, you know, very few organizations which are comparatively of small size, they prepare their final accounts on the basis of cash basis of accounting, where the transactions are recorded either in the debit side or credit side or liability side or asset side only on the basis of cash received or cash paid. But as far as accrual system of accounting is concerned, cash payment does not matter at all. So therefore, income receivable, if it is given in the adjustment, then income receivable must be recorded in the credit side of profit and loss account, and it must also be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet. But the question arises when the income receivable is shown only in the trial balance, then income receivable must be recorded only in the asset side of the balance sheet. Then income receivable cannot be recorded in the credit side of profit and loss account, because the income receivable would have already been adjusted while making a posting from journal to ledger and making a consolidated statement. So it means whatever amount is being reflected in the trial balance, that amount is reflected with the amount which we have already included in the income receivable. And as far as if income receivable is given in the adjustment, then definitely it need to be recorded first in the credit side of profit and loss account, and then second in the asset side of the balance sheet. Then next one is depreciation. So dear learners, you might be well aware about the depreciation. So depreciation is basically a loss or an expense to the business, because when we put the fixed assets into use, then definitely with the passage of the time, such assets get reduced its values. So any expenses or any loss to the business must be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account. So if the amount of depreciation is given in the adjustment, then the amount of depreciation, first it would be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account, and second the amount of depreciation must be deducted from the concerned assets, and only after deducting the amount of depreciation from the concerned assets it would be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet. Say for example, if I say that the business has plant and machine worth rupees 5 lakh, and the business has planned to charge the depreciation at the rate of 10%. So 10% of 5 lakh, that is rupees 50,000 rupees. So 50,000 rupees must be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account, and at the end of the year when we prepare a balance sheet, then the amount of depreciation, that is rupees 50,000, must be deducted from the book value of the asset, then it would be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet. That is 5 lakh minus 50,000, the net amount is 4,50,000. So this amount of rupees 4,50,000 must be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet. Now the question arises that if the amount of depreciation is given in the trial balance, so when the amount of depreciation is given in the trial balance, then how such informations would be treated in preparing the final accounts of the business? So when the amount of depreciation is given in the trial balance, then the amount of depreciation can only be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account, and such amount cannot be recorded in the cannot be deducted from the concerned assets while disclosing it in the asset side of the balance sheet. Then next one is interest on capital. So dear learner, interest on capital, see, as I had already told you that proprietor and business both are separate entity. So when any amount has been contributed by the proprietor in the business, then it is the duty of the business to pay the interest on the amount of capital to the proprietor. So in case if any interest is being paid by the business to the proprietor, then such interest is the expenses for the business and must be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account. And as far as the balance sheet is concerned, in the balance sheet, because such amount need to be paid to the proprietor in the time to come, so therefore it will stand as liabilities unless we make the payment to the proprietor. So therefore this amount of interest should also be recorded in the liabilities side of the balance sheet, or this amount of interest must be added to the proprietor's capital, and then the net amount must be recorded in the liabilities side of the balance sheet. Then the next one is interest on drawing. So very simple, sometimes what happens that when the proprietor withdrew some amount from the business for his personal use, for his personal purpose, not for the business purpose, so in that case the amount withdrawn by the proprietor from the business for his personal use, so any amount of interest on such drawing or amount withdrawn for the personal use becomes the income for the business. Therefore it must be recorded in the credit side of profit and loss account, and such amount of drawing, interest on drawing, must be deducted from the amount of capital, and after deducting the amount of interest on drawing, the net amount of capital must be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet. Then the next one is drawing of goods. Sometimes what happens, dear learners, that when the proprietor withdraw some amount of goods from the business, he does not withdraw the cash from the business, rather sometimes when he feels that the goods in which he is involved, that goods becomes useful for him, so he withdraw some goods from the business. So the treatment of such adjustments would be that the net amount of purchase which we have made for the business, that amount of purchase becomes reduced. So this amount must be deducted from the amount of purchases, and only after deducting the net amount of purchases must be recorded in the debit side of trading account. And the next one is goods used in business. Yes, dear learner, sometimes what happens that, say for example, if we are into a furniture business, so sometimes what happens that we use some sort of, you know, table and chairs in our office for entertaining the customer. So when you buy the goods for business perspective and you some of the furniture you use for the office purpose, so how would you treat such transactions while preparing the final accounts? Very simple. The first of all, the amount of furniture which we have used in your office for your office purpose, that amount must be deducted from the amount of purchases which we have made for the business purpose. And the second one is, because such furnitures become an asset for you, because you are using the furniture only for your business purpose, so that, you know, amount of furniture which we have, you have withdrawn from the business and you are using in the office just for the sake of entertaining the customer, or just for the sake of making your office more lucrative so that it can attract more and more customers, which ultimately led to the benefits of the organization. So this is the treatment which need to be made. Then the second one is bad debts. Next one is bad debts. So dear learners, you are well aware that the credit facility which is generally extended by the business to the customer, sometimes the full amount is not recovered by the business from the customer. So the amount which could not be recovered is known as bad debts. Since it is a loss for the business, therefore such amount should be recorded in the debit side of profit and loss account and must also be deducted from the amount of debtor, since this amount is not to be recovered, this amount cannot be recovered, this amount has already gone to debt, that cannot be recovered from the customer, therefore such amount must also be deducted from the amount of debtor and only the net amount must be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet. This is all about the adjustments in final accounts.
Okay, so one example you gave about the furniture, and what about the in case of electronics goods?
Yes. See, sometimes what happens, say for example, when we are dealing with the electronic goods, say for example, the TV is there, or sometimes we use washing machine, refrigerator. So any kind of furniture which is used for the business purpose, here it is very, very important to differentiate whether the furniture is used for the personal use or the furniture is used for the official use. So if it is for the personal use, then it becomes a drawing, and if it is used for the office purpose, then definitely it becomes an asset for the business and must be recorded in the asset side of the balance sheet. But if it is used for the personal purpose, then it becomes a drawing, and then definitely it must be deducted from the amount of proprietor's capital, and ultimately by the same amount the capital of the proprietor get reduced. This is how this treatment is made while preparing the final accounts of a particular business.